One way to view percentages is as fractions with a denominator of 100. There's also a direct relationship between the appearance of many percentages and their representation as decimals. So why do we bother having them at all? In most cases, it's to provide a common basis for comparison between fractions, or to help better express proportional increases and decreases. In a similar way to how, with fractions, we weren't able to easily add fractions with different denominators, when comparing, say, the fraction of shots a player makes in winning games against the fraction of shots a player makes in losing games, it makes it difficult to compare if these are proportions of different totals. By expressing these as a percentage, or as a rate per 100, we can more easily see any notable differences. Having percentages used as a standard tool for expressing ratios throughout our everyday language also helps us to gradually build intuition on how to use and interpret them. An interesting thing to note is that we can express percentages using whole numbers, as mixed numbers and fractions, or as decimals. And while this flexibility is useful, it can also create confusion when we want to turn percentages back into numbers for calculation. A mental strategy you might like to consider to keep your mathematical feet grounded is to refer back to a few benchmarks that you have a good intuitive feel for. So 50% is a half, or 0.5, or 5 tenths, and 10% is a tenth, or 0.1. This makes it easy to recognize that 1 is the same as 100%, and 2 is 200%, but also that 0.05% must be much smaller than 0.05, the decimal. When converting between percentages and decimals, one strategy is to consider the place value of numbers. When we have a percentage, we're actually saying hundredths, so it's as if our base unit is the hundredths column. If we want to think of the same numbers as decimals, we just need to change our reference point to the units column. If we're converting percentages to fractions, the usual first step is to express these over 100. We then might be able to cancel down if the numerator is divisible by 5 or 2. On the other hand, if the numerator is a mixed number, then we might be better off converting to an improper fraction and using division. If the numerator is a decimal, we can look for an equivalent ratio of whole numbers. Some potential options are to consider multiplying by 10 to get rid of anything that's expressed to one decimal place, or 100 to get rid of anything that's expressed to two decimal places. However, in some cases, we might also be able to recognize the multiplier that multiplies the numerator to become a whole number. For instance, if we have 5 tenths, which is the same as a half, we can multiply by 2 to produce a whole number. If we have 2 tenths, we can multiply by 5, and so on. As well as being comfortable converting between different representations, one of the other key proficiencies when it comes to percentages is understanding percentage change. And the key for this is that any change is always expressed as a percentage of the original amount. So increasing by 50% means we're taking 50% of the original quantity and adding it on. So we'd now have 150% of the original quantity. But it also makes sense to increase something by 110%, which actually would mean we're adding on an amount that's 110% of, or 1.1 times the size of the original amount. The new amount then would represent 210% of what was there in the first place. While percentages are very useful for giving us the overall picture of a situation, when interpreting comparisons, we should always be wary of where the data comes from. Take this example, which is commonly used to illustrate what's called Simpson's paradox. Suppose there are two pilots, and we want to compare their performance in landing flights on time. For one pilot, 83% of flights were on time, while for the other, 78% were on time. This seems like a straightforward comparison. Clearly, the first pilot is more timely. But then, if we're a little skeptical and put our critique glasses on, we might ask where these figures came from. And we're told that it was 100 out of 120 on-time flights for the first pilot, and then 94 out of 120 for the second. Well, this all seems to make sense. Clearly, the first pilot is more timely. But then, if we know anything about flying, which I don't, but the person who wrote this example might, it's actually much easier to land flights on time during the day than it is during night. So actually, if we break down these percentages by day and night, a very odd thing occurs. The second pilot has a better percentage during the day and a better percentage at night. But because he or she has flown more at night, the overall percentage is brought down. The same thing could happen if you were comparing basketball players in terms of their two-point and three-point field goal percentage. So what does this mean? Just that percentages themselves always should be understood in the right context. When used wisely, they can be very helpful for making sense from data. So we'll see them play a big role in the next two topics.